So we shall continue with Wole Soyinka's telephone conversation. Just a short recap of what we had done yesterday. The tenant is calling up the white landowner, the landlord, the landlady, and they are speaking as long as the landlady does not realize the fact that the tenant is the person on the other side of the phone is a black person. And the moment she realizes this, there is a silence which expresses much more than what she... what her speech expresses. And herein lies the seriousness of the poem. Now, she has been, narrator mocks her to mocks in a very mocking way. He tells us that she comes from a very genteel, sophisticated, well-mannered background, and that is why she is refraining from directly insulting the man. And she resorts to questions which make her implications quite clear, that she wants to discourage any form of communication with this person. She asks him about the degree of his lightness, something that is being ridiculed by Soyinka by a comparison to daily objects like plain or milk chocolate and so on and so forth. So we continue from after this. Her accent was clinical, crushing in light impersonality, rapidly wavelength adjusted. I chose West African sepia. And as underthought, down at my passport, silence for retroscopic flight of fancy till truthfulness changed her accent. He's speaking about the accent. Her accent was clinical. Now, clinical means to the point, absolutely to the point. When you do not, now this is again a kind of oxymoron in sentences where she is beating around the bush when she is speaking. Her speech is beating around the bush, but her accent is very clinical. It absolutely tells the speaker what her mentality is and what she desires from this communication, which is never to have it again. Now, crushing in light impersonality. So she's speaking in a manner which is very mundane, which is very common, which is very not so serious, but we all know the seriousness of the underlying fact. And I chose West African sepia. As you know, sepia is a, for those who are interested in photography and filters, you are well, you must be well acquainted with the word sepia. It's a brownish, yellowish, dark brownish kind of filter. So, yeah, the man replies that it is almost being similar to a dark brunette. So, as is written, see the last three lines of the last three lines of the explanation. So, humanity is being brought down to colors, certain color codes which define their importance, or their humanity is getting defined by certain color codes. There are certain color codes which are shown to be humane, certain color codes which are shown to be less humane, and then there are color codes which are absolutely inhumane. So now again, this dark brunette, where why does it come up? Because again, this is a mocking of the lady, mocking of the entire institution that harbors racism. Because dark brunette is considered to be that color which is somewhat not inhumane, but not also humane. It's somewhere between humane and inhumane. It is accepted, but with certain reservations. It is only to bring forth this bane of mankind that Soyinka is using these ideas and satirizing this entire institution of racism. Hard on the mouthpiece. What's that? Conceding. Don't know what that is. Like brunette? That's dark, isn't it? Not altogether. Facially I'm brunette. But madam, you should see the rest of me. Palm of my hand, sole of my feet are a peroxide blonde. Friction caused foolishly, madam, by sitting down has turned my bottom raven black. One moment, madam, sensing her receiver rearing on the thunderclap. About my ears, madam, I pleaded, wouldn't you rather see for yourself? But this is a poem, and again, a very satirical, sarcastic description. We are still dwelling on the narrator and the landlady. They are still dwelling on the degree of blackness. And the lady wants to be absolutely sure. She wants to be absolutely sure about the color complexion. She does not want any can be this, can be that. She wants to have a specific answer about how this person is, how what this person, what the color of this person's skin is. And again, the answer comes again in a very sarcastic manner. Palm of my hand and sole of my feet are peroxide blown. You know, look at the palms of our hands or the feet of our feet. It's always lighter than your skin. So he tells her that the palm of my hand and my feet, sole of my feet are peroxide blown. They are blown. So would that count for being blown? And then again, the final moment of the end game of all sarcasm in this poem. Friction caused foolishly, madam, by sitting down has turned my bottom raven black. So he's bringing up his bottom into the poem, and this is just a way in which he tries to absolutely satirize and perhaps bring forth the stupidity of this entire institution of racism. When he is bringing up his bottom into the question. Now, we don't normally, it is something that we love to hide. It is something that is always kept under wraps. But here, Soyinka is speaking of the bottom, speaking of his bottom, which he says is raven black. Raven is a crow. Those of you who are acquainted with Bengali must have heard of Darkak. A raven is a Darkak. So again, just imagine what Soyinka is trying to hit home. His bottom is raven black, but he apologizes to the landlady because it has been foolishly caused by him sitting down, which causes friction, and friction generally causes the surface to lose its color. So this is kind of the height of the, if we kind of try to gauge the entire poem in graphs, the graph of sarcasm hits its highest point here, where he's not only ridiculing, it might as well look that he's ridiculing himself, but he is simultaneously, contrastively, he's ridiculing every institution that has implemented this idea and this concept of racism, this silly concept of racism, and he's trying to bring out the stupidity of this entire concept, where the skin itself is not consistent with its color throughout. So what should be taken to be the consistent notion, the consistent gauge for mapping color? A receiver rearing on the thunderclap about my ears, madam, I pleaded, wouldn't you rather see for yourself? And this is, the poem ends in a heightened sense of excitement. The landlady has had enough. She has had enough. She has understood all she wanted to understand, and her answer is pretty clear. Now, there are two things in this putting down the receiver with a thud. Now, there are two things. One is that she realizes the fact that how black this person is, and she's absolutely disinterested anymore. And so she puts down the phone in a manner of insulting, so on and so forth. But the other thing is also something that we must bear in mind, is that the narrator points out to the lady, shows the reality of her baseless racism. But we cannot ignore the fact that perhaps the lady puts down the phone because she, for once, is privy to her real self, which she is unable to accept. A self that denominates human beings, humanity, on the basis of color, and not on the basis of values. And the moment the reality is brought in front of her, it is only obvious that she is going to keep the phone because her institutionalization has been that which has always made her believe the fact that racism is good, that she is of a superior race and whatever she is doing is proper, in line with the code of ethics of humanity and civilization. So there is a double play on this receiver rearing on a thunderclap. So this is basically the poem. It's a poem about racism and keeping in line with the text that you have in your syllabus, starting from Martin Luther King, which deals with racism. Then, O Captain, My Captain, which is written, the setting of which is this American Civil War, which has to do with racism. So just like Martin Luther King and Wole Soyinka is presenting, and we will see when we do the novel we have, To Kill a Mockingbird, that the Negro, the black angle of racism is seen. Similarly, we saw the response, the white response in Walt Whitman's O Captain, My Captain. Okay, I will say a few words about the poetic structure, because this is something very striking and important in terms of this poem. As I was telling you at the beginning of the poem, that the poem is written in blank verse and it uses something called the caesura. C-A-E-S-U-R-A-S. Now what a caesura is caesura is breaking up of lines at various lengths, putting up a pause, putting up a silence at various lengths, which is used to kind of emphasize certain facts over the others. Now, Soyinka uses caesura in this poem, Telephone Conversation, because again, this is a telephone conversation, and that is how telephone conversations pan out in real life. We don't speak endlessly or in a rhyme. We stop and speak again, stop and speak again. We emphasize on something more, we emphasize on something less. And the second is enjambment. You see the word written there, enjambed. The actual word is enjambment, which means pulling up a line beyond its end limit. And this is again something that we see that Soyinka is doing in the poem. He is stretching a line beyond its end limits to again. So we are having difficulties in trying to point out, find out where the line begins and where the line must end. And as a result of which, we are not quite sure which of the line is the essential part and which of the line is the unessential part. So again, speaking continuously, what does it express? It expresses that the speaker has great self-individuality, that the speaker is something of is someone of intellect. You can only keep on speaking if your intellect is of the highest order. And that is why Soyinka uses enjambment here to just bring forth the individuality, that the black person here is an individual who is no less than the white woman, perhaps even greater than the white woman. He is self-assured, he knows what he's speaking about, and he does not need people to tell him what to do and what not to say. I think this much of the poetic structure would be enough. Of course, thoughts regarding these in your answers are always welcome. Now, these are some possible questions. Question on racism is something that is very important, and the prevalent themes is also very important. The annotated questions, RTCs, are reference to the context where a couple of lines may be quoted from the text and you will be asked to explain the lines with reference to the context. You will have to give a context of the poem. You will have to, and then you will have to explain what the lines are saying, and then you will have to give the deeper impression of those lines. The role of color in Soyinka's poem, this is again consistent with the racism theme. How does Soyinka bring forth human divide in his poem and discuss hypocrisy of human life? Now, in the poems, intertextuality is always encouraged. So when you are writing answers of Soyinka, you're always welcome to refer to Martin Luther King or O Captain, My Captain, or the novel To Kill a Mockingbird. And similarly, simultaneously, when you're writing their answers, you are encouraged to refer to these texts that you have inside in your syllabus, because the broad umbrella beneath which they all are habitated is racism. So I hope you've understood the basic points that I'm trying to explain. So this is O Captain, My Captain. This is Volso Inka's telephone conversation. You can contact me if you have any problems. Thank you.